So this data is not as current as what I just showed you on the web on Statista, I think it's Statista, .com. But as you could see, we saw this exponential style growth, right? Definitely a curve, or maybe it's quadratic. We know it will eventually turn into logistic. And then we also saw kind of a quadratic decline in sales too, didn't we? Okay, so definitely looks like a parabola, and it's an upside down parabola, so it has a negative A in front of the x squared of some sort. So let's say that we try to model this linearly, and the linear is not a good model for it, but we'll do our best. We have something with a slope of 26.384 and a y-intercept of a negative 44 point something. Okay, so that's something of a line that kind of represents that particular, the iPod sales, definitely a trend down, right? So if we're trying to match this linearly, it's a negative. So here's our trend up, here's our trend down. If we want to know how many sales we have altogether, what would we do? I have one equation with iPod sales. I have one equation with iPhone sales. I want to see the two together. I'm going to together means add. Yeah, we're just going to add them up. Okay. So when we add the two equations up, this would be the trend line. Okay. So we're definitely, or apples, but definitely better off with their phone than without, right? Make sense? Which is what we would predict. Okay. So that's an arithmetic combination of two functions. Arithmetic combination of functions, and you don't have to write all this out if you don't want to. It's all on page 76 of your book, Some Difference Product Quotient. So you can save yourself some time and say, see page 76 in your notes if you want. This says that if f and g are functions with overlapping domains, okay, in other words, I would have needed to start the iPod equation in 2007 when the iPhones were introduced, then for all x common in both domains, the function f plus g of x is equal to f of x plus g of x. The function f minus g of x is equal to f of x minus g of x. The function f times g of x, multiply the two together, f divided by g of x, we divide the two functions. Dividing, we have to be careful that g is not equal to 0 because we can never divide by 0. All right, so when we have two functions, f of x is 2x minus 5, and g of x is 2 minus x, the first thing we want to do is find f plus g of x. Our previous screen said if we want to do that, we simply take f of x and add on g of x. Remember these from last year? Okay. So when we do that, what do we get? X minus 3, right? Combine your like terms. 2x minus x is a positive x. A negative 5 and a positive 2 is a negative 3. F minus g of x says to take f and subtract g of x. So what do we have to remember to do here? Distribute that negative. 2x plus x now, right? Write them out of order, but 2x plus x is going to be 3x, and we'll have a negative 7, right? F times g. What are we going to do? Boil it out, right? Multiply, distribute, what you want to call it. And then we like to combine like terms and put them in descending powers of x. We'll try to give you things out of order sometimes and see if they can mess with your mind. No, it should have been a plain old 5 plus 5. Completely erase. All right, f divided by g. They're already in nice, pristine form, right? And so there's nothing really we can do with that. We just leave it as it is. But what can't x be? Let x be equal to 2, or it's not defined. So far, so good? All right. So what in the heck are they asking us for when we say this? Exactly. Do the f plus g, which we already simplified, right? F of f plus g was equal to x minus 3. So everywhere we see an x, we're going to plug in a 5. Questions on this one? All right, feeling good? All right, next one then. Now we want to talk about composition of functions. Okay, composition of functions of f with the function g. Our book likes to write it this way, f composed with g. Kind of looks like the word fog, right? And all it's saying is that we're taking g of x, and everywhere we see an x in f, we plug it in. Okay, we're taking that whole function, the second function, the one on the right, the one on the inside, and plugging it in everywhere we see an x in the other function. So if f of x is x squared minus 9, and g of x is the square root of 9 minus x squared, and we want to find f composed with g, we're going to take that g of x. Everywhere we see an x, an f, we're going to plug it in. So we'll have a square root of 9 minus x squared, squared, that's my x squared, and then take away 9. What happens if you square a square root? They cancel, they're inverse functions. So we'll have 9 minus x squared minus 9, which is going to give us negative x squared. Happens provided that the domains are overlapping and our final domain has to be the same as what the original was, restricted by the original function's domains. Make sense? Yes, sir. I was trying to think of a real world example business wise when we would compose the two functions like this, and I haven't come up with one. That's not to say that there isn't a real-world case for it. I just couldn't think of one off the top of my head. Does that make sense? But how we apply it is we can see if two functions are inverses of each other or not. That's coming up next section. And we do that by composing the two together. And if we get x back, we know that they're inverses of each other. So there'll be a reflection across the line y equals x. Okay? So business case, I was really struggling. I tried to think of a way that we would use that, and I couldn't think of one off the top of my head, but I didn't have a lot of time to go through it. So far, so good? Any other questions on this one? Okay, so given f of x is x squared plus 2x, and g of x is 2x plus 1, which we're going to find f composed with g, and then later we'll find g composed with f. F composed with g says that we're going to take this x squared plus 2x and this 2x plus 1 and compose them. This goes in everywhere we see an x and f. So let me show you the shortcut for squaring something. When you need to square 2x plus 1, didn't learn this last year, it's a shortcut, you'll save you a lot of time this year. Instead of writing them side by side and foiling them out, we square the first term, then you multiply the two together and double, double is times two, and then you square the last. When we square the first term, 2x squared is going to be 2x times 2x is 4x squared. Multiply these two together. 1 times 2x is 2x. Double it. 4x. And square the last, we get 1. It's the same as foiling it out. So easy time. And now we need to multiply the 2 times 2x and the 2 times the 1, distributing that through, and then we combine our like terms. And that's f composed with g. All right, find g composed with f. This one's a little simpler, right? We're just is taking 2 times that x squared plus 2x, adding 1. Questions on this one? All right, feeling good? Okay. So, here's the last piece. Decomposing a function. And this is an introductory exposure kind of concept, not a mastery concept. So we'll make you do tougher stuff on the homework and back it down for the test. So this one wouldn't be something that you would necessarily see on the test unless it was a bonus. Okay? But we want to find 2 functions, f and g, such that when we compose f with g, we get a new function h of x, which is the square root of 2 minus x squared over 3. And there's no one right answer to this. There are multiple right answers to this. So think of this as something like I need something that when I grab something else and plug it into every x I see, I'll get this back. Okay. Ideas on where to start. Well, we want to, the idea is that we have to have an f of x and a g of x, such that when we grab whatever's in g of x and plug it into f of x, we get this for our answer. What do you think? What do you think? We're trying to get this as our answer. We have basically an answer, and we're missing the 2 things that we're going to put together. Okay. So, okay. And in place of this, we want an x, and we need a 3. Did that work? Absolutely. So this could be our g of x, and this could be our f of x. Everywhere we see g, we plug in x, and we're done. Okay? Anybody have an alternate idea? I said there's more than one right answer to this. What if we decided to let g of x be x squared? And what would f of x have to be? Square root of 2 minus x all over 3. So you see that there's lots of ways that you could do this, okay? As long as when you compose them, you get the original, or the h back, we're good, okay? All right, so that's what you're doing today. Now, to shorten things up a little bit, this is the assignment that was on your yellow sheet, in the calendar, on your phone, right, and so forth. The bold and underlined ones are the required problems. So I'm going to let you have as much practice as you need. You know which ones give you trouble and which ones don't, right? I don't want it to be boring and redundant and waste your time when you have other classes that you're working on or other things that you can focus on. But I want to see for sure that you do problem 7, 11, 17, 19, and so on. The other ones around them are similar to them, right? So if you need more help with, and you struggle with number 11, then do 9 and 15 as well, or 9 and 13 as well. Okay, so the required ones, the only ones that I would grade if I grade for understanding and not a completion grade, would be the bold and underline. Yes, sir. Which one's up there twice? I'm sorry. 31, because I messed up and put it up there twice. It's out of order here. I mistyped it. So I'll fix it for next year. Okay. you know how much you practice you need. If it's easy and you got it and you can nail it down, no problem. If you need more help or more time or more practice, you've got other ones to work on. All right.